I am not a cruel master. I am a compassionate, loving, gracious God for you. To reveal that, Joseph had to take them through various tests, experiences. One is that they came to a state, we don't want to break the heart of our father in his old age. We don't want to send him to the grave with a sorrow, to bring down my father with gray hairs to the grave. I don't want to do it. In these modern times, many young people are doing that. They break the heart of their parents. Are there any young people here seated who are doing this still? The way you are doing it, one day with sorrow, your father and your mother may go to the grave. And afterwards, it's no use taking some bouquets and flowers and go and cry in the grave. Oh, I gave a hard time for my mother. I gave a hard time for my father. With sorrow, he had to go to the grave. With sorrow, my mother had to go to the grave. I broke their heart. That will be too late. And that will also deprive you of your heavenly father to be revealed to you. We all have done once. If there are young people seated here, rebelling against your parents, breaking their hearts, today I plead with you. Don't do that. Now what Judah says? Judah is now willing to lay down his life. What he says to the governor, this young boy, this Benjamin, my father is so attached to, he is the youngest child in the old age of my father. Therefore, if the child is not there, and if we keep him here and kept us a slave or a bond servant, as soon as my father will hear about it, it will break his heart. In this old age, he will die. And with his gray hairs, with sorrow, will go into the grave. I don't want to do that. Therefore, he says, sir, I am willing to lay down my life broken. I ask you, this should be the decision every young person has to do today. If you do like that, read the 32nd verse.
For thy servant became surety for the lad unto my father, saying, if I bring him not unto thee, then I shall bear the blame to my father forever.
See, here, he next verse says that I want to be a born man for that. In other words, I am willing to do anything and everything so that my father, in his old age, his heart will not be broken. Dear children of God, we all have broken our parents' hearts once upon a time. I hope not now. But if there is anybody here doing that again, whether young or old, we should make that. I don't mean to say for the sake of standing for the truth. Sometimes unconverted parents may not understand the truth. That is a different thing. But what I am telling, by doing wrong things and with a hardened heart, walking in the wrong way, going in the wrong way, if you are breaking your father's and mother's heart, one thing I want to tell you. You may never know Jesus, the goodness of Jesus, that reality of Jesus, the graciousness, the character of Jesus may never be revealed to you. We read the 45th chapter. It starts with, I am Joseph. He revealed himself to them. Before I go to the next, I would like all of us to close our eyes. If you and I have foolishly disobeyed and rebelled against our parents and broken their hearts, I ask you today, ask the Lord to forgive you. Like Judah, make a decision. Lord, even if I have to lay down my life unscripturally or against the truth of God, foolishly, I don't want to break the heart of my father or mother. Perhaps some of your father and mother, you already sent them to the grave. But I tell you, you got a heavenly father. Don't break his heart. Father, we pray, Lord, help me, O God. Yes, Lord, I have done it, O God. Maybe many of us seated here have done it. One thing we all have done, Father, we have broken the heart of our heavenly Father. Like Judah, our Father, even if we have to lay down our life for God, sacrifice anything, help us not to grieve the heart of God, not to break the heart of God. I pray for the young people seated here who have been breaking the hearts of the mother and the father. At least today, Lord, open their spiritual eyes, not to break their hearts, not to send the parents to the grave with sorrow, but let them become source of comfort and encouragement, O God. Thank you, Father, for helping us. In Jesus' name, Amen. We read, please read the verse 30. Chapter 44. We are on chapter 44.
Now therefore, when I come to thy servant my father, and the lad be not with us, seeing that his life is bound up in the lad's life.
Here, this is a warning now to the parents. And Jacob, what we find, Jacob's life is bound up in the lad's life. His life was so much attached that Judah was able to say, if the lad is not found one day, my father will die. His life is bound up in the lad's life. And if the lad is not found, my father will die. He was too much attached to the son or the youngest son. Listen, all the parents, if you get too much attached to any of your children, that child, when they grow up, will become a great source of problem for you. This is what it happened to Jacob. He did not learn the lesson. First, he was attached to whom? To Joseph. He was attached to, so much attached to Joseph, and he gave a multicolored coat. And what happened? I don't mean to say your children will become wicked. Children may be good, but when they grow up, they will become a source of great problem for you. You ask anyone, anywhere, whether this truth, principle or truth is correct or not. If you get too much attached to anyone, parents of course, I am telling about children. If you get attached more than what God wants you to be attached, when they grow up, listen, they will be a great problem for you. And for because now he was attached to Joseph, and one day when he was 17 only, he realized my son is dead and gone. How long he was crying, you know, for his son? Over 20 years he didn't know where the son was. The more he got attached and the more he loved, that more brought sorrow into his life. Now, after that is over, he didn't learn the lesson. He was attached to Benjamin. Now, Benjamin is becoming a source of worry and care and fear for him. Oh, without, what will happen to my son? When Jacob was sending away his sons for food to Egypt, he purposely told, no, I don't want to send Benjamin, some mischief will happen to him. Why? They could only think about one person only, that some mischief will happen. If mischief is happening, all the 11 brethren who are gone, it could happen. Or one among them. Particularly he was concerned about that. And he was worried. And he told, oh, my son Benjamin will not go with you. Several times we find such a fear attached to that. So if you get attached to anyone more than what God wants you, not only about children. Anyone you get too much attached. I don't mean to say loving that person more than God. You may say, no, I don't love my child more than God. That may be true. But are you too much attached to a particular person than what God wants you to? Either God will take that person out of you. That's what happened. For 20 years, Joseph was taken out of him. And he had to suffer a lot. What a mental torture it could have been. Whenever he will look at that multicolored coat, oh my son, I couldn't see the dead body. I couldn't attend even the funeral. How did he die? What type of wild animals might have killed him? Oh, it might have tormented his mind. That all what we learn is that Jacob loved Joseph and Benjamin too much, and that brought problem for himself. For you and I, not only children, anyone, our relationship should be according to what God wants us to be. I learned also, there was a particular church when I loved a couple of believers really very much in a particular country while I was working. And I found I felt so happy about their spiritual life and how they come to church and various good things I really appreciated. I didn't realize I was really getting attached to them. They became a great problem for me later on. Then I didn't realize, and a misunderstanding took place. I cried to the Lord, "Lord, why it's like that? I have been loving them so much and caring for them so much. Why they are creating problem?" Then the Lord put the finger on the wrong place of my heart. Hey, this is what happened. You were too much attached. So wherever you are loving your husband, you are loving your wife, you are loving your brother or sister or whatever relationship may be, but there is a balanced state. If you go beyond that and love that person too much, you be prepared. That person very soon is going to be troublemaker for you. Not that person is willingly doing that. Joseph was not willingly troubling Jacob, was he? No. Benjamin was not troubling Jacob purposely. But things happen like that. But this lesson doesn't seem to, although we know this, people don't seem to take this lesson. No too much attachment, friendship. Some young people also get a too much attachment. And when a boy is getting attached to the girl, and that is hell. Remember that is going to be one of the worst things. Our love should be divine, balanced, coming from God. And even the measure, we should check the measure. Some people the other way around, they don't love also. Anyway, it should be in a balanced state. When God becomes, and now another thing that we find about Jacob, as soon as Joseph, he lost his peace and happiness, as we learned earlier. He made a grave and he was waiting to die with sorrow. What we learn that, if God is our exceeding joy, then even if anybody is taken out of us, that will not disturb our peace and happiness. But when you have something more than God, exceeding joy, God can see that. And one day God may take it out of you. Then you lose your peace, you lose your happiness, you lose your appetite, you lose your sleep. When I say you, it includes, very much includes me. So therefore, as we read in Psalms, God is my exceeding joy. When God becomes our exceeding joy, anything that we receive or taken out of our life, that does not disturb us. But if anything taken out of you, that immediately make you to lose your sleep and peace and joy, the reason is this: you loved that person or that thing or that matter more than what God wants you to love, more than what God wants you to love. Then let us turn to something that shall we read the 34th verse before we go to the 33 and 34.
"Now therefore I pray thee, let thy servant abide instead of the lad a bondman to my lord, and let the lad go up with his brethren. For how shall I go up to my father, and the lad be not with me, lest peradventure I see the evil that shall come on my father?"
As I told you earlier, here we find a really changed Judah. Judah, in the 33rd verse, is a classic example of how we have to make intercessions. We know there are four types of prayers. One is prayers and supplications and thanksgiving and intercession. This is an exemplary verse for intercession. What is an intercession? Here, "Now therefore I pray thee, let thy servant abide instead of the lad a bondman to my lord." Intercession means you take the place of somebody else in affliction. Suppose, as I say, you are praying for somebody in a wheelchair, "Oh Lord, raise that person up." That is prayer. But intercession is that you feel that you are in the wheelchair, the pain and the suffering that you could feel in your heart, and then you pray. That is real agonizing prayer. That is called intercession. Jesus in heaven, what is he now doing? He is not praying or supplication. It is not praising or thanksgiving. What he is doing as the high priest for us, he is making intercession for us. In one sense, intercession is the greatest experience in communication with God. Everybody cannot intercede. Perhaps we may be able to pray. Intercession means you take the place of that person. You are praying for a person with cancer. You feel as if you have that cancer. You feel that. You identify yourself with that person. Then that prayer becomes agony. You feel it is your own child. Or something that you have blood relation. Otherwise, Lord, please help that dear brother suffering with cancer or suffering with this, that. We may pray and say Amen. But intercession, you feel the pain and the pangs and the sorrow and the suffering as in your spirit you can feel it. And then when you pray, there is agony. There is a real, see how Jesus interceded that we find. This is what, and afterwards only we find Joseph revealed himself to them. Isaiah 53 verse 11 and 12. Here we find how Jesus interceded.
He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors.
See, finally only written, made intercession for the transgressors. Before making intercession, what are the things that Jesus had done? First of all, he shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many. Here we find the contrast. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, justify others. What normally people do when there is a problem with two or three people, by our knowledge we will try to justify ourselves and put the blame upon, hey, it's Raymond Jr. who has done that, not I myself. Yes, he is guilty about it. I can prove it. There are so many proofs. Number one is this. Number two is this. What we will do? By our knowledge, we will justify ourselves. But what did Jesus do? It's the other way around. By his knowledge, shall my righteous servant justify many others. If you are a clever person, you will be able to justify yourself more. But by his knowledge, he shall justify many. How can you justify many? For he shall bear their iniquities. That is what Jesus has done. He took all our iniquities upon himself, and by his knowledge he justified us. And he became sin for us. So to intercede and pray, we should have that spirit. Somebody is, for example, backslidden and gone away from the church. Yes, I had been telling him several times, don't do that. Don't behave like that. He didn't listen that. See, therefore he is backslidden. Therefore he has fallen into such a pit. I told him. Several times I told him. Yes, he is guilty. Therefore he is backslidden and gone. That is, Lord, please bring him back and forgive him. We may pray. But that is not intercession. Intercession that you feel, Lord, I could have been that person backslidden and gone away. I could have been on the street like that with drugs and this and that. Lord, I am guilty. I may not have prayed enough for that person. I may not have really shown compassion. So you take the place of that person. By his knowledge, he shall justify many. When there is arguments and fightings and quarrels, if we will do this, immediately arguments and fighting will stop. For the glory of God, I can say recently Pastor Don had been to a particular church and he found problems in the church. But he went and told, I take all the blame upon me. It's all my mistake. And one of the persons with whom there was problems, he went to his house and he washed his feet. taking all the blame upon him. He is far away from here and hardly knowing anything, the problem there, that brother started weeping. Pastor, there was no need for you to apologize like that before others. But that is what word of God says. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many and will bear their iniquities upon him. In our church, if there are problems, in your family there are problems, the reason is that we have not taken this, what is written in the 11th verse. We want to just find fault with others, we want to justify ourselves. I am right, she is wrong. And she will say, I am right, he is wrong. And then pandemonium. So he justified after bearing their iniquities. If we do that, he says, therefore will I divide him a portion with the great. That is a great experience. There are so many meanings of that, but I don't want to go into that. And he shall divide the spoil with the strong. You know, spoil is something you get from the enemy, isn't it? When we take the blame upon us for any problem, then we are really spoiling the enemy. And he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors. So we take the place of the transgressor. We take the place of the sinners when we pray for sinners. We take the place of backsliders when we pray for the backsliders. We pray for the, if somebody is rebellious, we take the place. And we pray. That is it. Beautiful. You identify yourself with that transgressor. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. That is why we read elsewhere in Ezekiel, and we read, God was wondered because there are no intercessors. If God is wondering, is it Ezekiel chapter 13 verse 5? Oh no, sorry, 59, Isaiah 59. Verse 16. So this is what, dear children of God, we need to have. What I wanted to, the important fact that I want to bring home tonight is that as soon as Judah became the intercessor, he wanted to take the place of Benjamin and he wanted to become a bond servant or to be killed. Then the time came that Joseph to reveal himself to him. Read.
And he saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor.
That is enough. See, if God is surprised, you know, God is not an ordinary God. It's the Almighty God. He says, God wondered, God was surprised that there was no intercessor. If God is surprised, what a great surprise it is. If God wondered and he saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor, he didn't say there is nobody to pray. He didn't say there is nobody to give thanks. All these things are needed. But God says he wondered. There is no intercessor. I already told you the meaning of intercessor means you take the place of that person. You take all the blame upon yourself. Husbands, you take the blame of your wife and pray, intercede for that person. You find you will have a heavenly family. And wives, you take the blame of your husband. I didn't love, I didn't pray, I didn't care. That is why all the problem. Husband, it is not your problem. I am to be blamed. Then the wife will say, no, I am to be blamed. You are right. And normally what do we see? The other way around. And then unending problems. This brings really heaven. What we find here, God wondered because there are no intercessors. Are there anybody here today who wants to be an intercessor? Even if in your family, within the small family, the whole family, if there are some problems, if you stand, I am to be blamed. Yes, put all the blame upon me. And then you pray and intercede. You find marvelous results. Servants of God, we are also called to do like that. When we intercession is not prayer. It is not supplication. It is not thanksgiving. For that we says he hath poured out his soul unto death. It is not easy thing, but God is looking for intercessors. Shall we make a decision? Lord, I want to be an intercessor. I want to, Lord, by my knowledge, I want to justify many, but because he shall bear their iniquities. I don't mean to say something wrong. Somebody had committed a murder and you are going to the police and say, I am the one who had done. I don't mean to say that in the natural way. In the spiritual sense, taking the blame. Lord, if I had done, I have prayed enough for that person or loved or cared or if I had shown your compassion. You know, I'm telling the spiritual way. God may really make us mighty intercessors in the presence of God. Shall we lift up the hands and praise God? Hallelujah. Praise you, God. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, glory to God. Help me, oh God. Help me, oh God. Help me, oh God. Help me, oh God. Hallelujah. 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 And coming back to chapter 44, the last verse we read, for how shall I go up to my father and the lad be not with me? Lest peradventure I see the evil that shall come on my father. How shall I go up to my father if the child is not with me? Saints in Zion, they shall see the father's face. For that, what should be done? Even the youngest or the smallest and the most despised person, we should bear that person in our heart. Prefer others better than ourselves. Often that we may compare ourselves with others and we may find we are better than others. It shouldn't be. Husband should think that my wife is better than myself. Wife should say, in the spirit, should take that way. You never know, dear children of God, when the spiritual eyes are open, we may see that. Anyway, that is the word of God also says, prefer others better than ourselves. Without that, we see that you cannot see the Father's face. And just we'll finish reading the first verse of next chapter. Chapter 45, verse 1. Please read.
Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood by him. And he cried, cause every man to go out from me. And there stood no man with him while Joseph made himself known unto his brethren.
Praise be to God. When Joseph revealed himself, really things changed. When we really have a real understanding, knowledge, revelation of our Jesus, things change. There are few beautiful things. Let me close it by saying that. Now I ask you, hereafter you read the Bible, do you find any time Joseph is hard on them afterwards? From this chapter 45 verse 1, you go through the Bible, hold through the Bible, you will never find Joseph hard on them. Before that, often there you find Joseph is hard, Joseph is hard. Joseph is speaking, calling the spies, and Joseph is arresting. Joseph is putting in the prison. What's wrong with Joseph? But here, when Joseph revealed himself to them, it is not that Joseph was changed. Their spiritual eyes were open to see. Joseph was kind and compassionate even before, but they couldn't understand it. When Joseph gave the free food and sack full of free corn and the money was restored, that was his kindness, but they couldn't see that. When Joseph invited them to their banquet and had a nice dinner with them, they couldn't understand. What did they think? This governor is calling us to his house to take our donkeys. That is why he's calling. They couldn't understand it. Our Jesus is the same yesterday, today and forever. But we can understand our Jesus to be gracious and kind only when our spiritual eyes are open. Now, before Joseph revealed himself to them, Joseph was speaking in a different language, isn't it? There was an interpreter needed. Now, after Joseph revealed himself to them, no interpreter. Joseph started speaking in plain language. Sometimes we find that we don't understand. God is not speaking to me. I don't understand what he says. An interpreter has to be used. Somebody has to help us to know. In one sense, I am telling you, of course, it's good that others may help us to know the word of God. But now, in what language Joseph started speaking? Hebrew language. Hebrew language, according to them, is a holy language. And now no more interpreter needed. And now no more Joseph is hard on them. And now, another most, perhaps one of the most interesting things, is that. If you read earlier, before Joseph revealed himself to the brethren, brethren had most of the talk. Most of the time it was Joseph keeping quiet and they were talking and talking and talking. Look at from that so many verses that you find in the 44th chapter itself. Hardly Joseph speaks in the 44th chapter. Right up to the end, 34th verse, it is the brothers who have been speaking. Now from the 45th chapter, the first verse what we find is Joseph speaking. Joseph's brothers hardly speaks. What we understand, dear children of God, that when we get a revelation of the goodness and love of Jesus, how he is altogether lovely, when we go to the presence of God, we can be in the sweet communion with him and he will just keep speaking to us. Many of us are today like Joseph's brethren. We pray for 1 hour and then we ask, did Jesus speak anything to you? No, I prayed for 1 hour, but he didn't speak anything to me today. Said, who is speaking more? We are speaking. And we don't give a chance for Joseph to speak to us. But when we really get a glimpse of the glory of Joseph, Jesus, then he starts speaking to us. And we will say, Amen, 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 Amen. Now I ask you, dear children, how far we are from a real revelation about Joseph. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And the people that know him shall be strong and will do exploits. I ask you, dear child of God, do you know Joseph really? It is true. You have been in the banqueting table eating spiritual food with Joseph. It is true. Joseph has been giving you corn, spiritual food. He has been giving you money. He has been calling you to his house to eat with him. And so many good things he has been doing to you. But I ask you, do you really know your Joseph? If you really know him, you will speak less. That means in the presence of God, we can really get lost. He will be speaking more. When Moses was in the mountain of glory, 14 days and 40 nights, we don't read anyway, hardly Moses speaking to God. God was speaking to Moses. In the island of Patmos, when the glory of God appeared to John, hardly John spoke. In book of Revelation, we read most of them, it was Jesus who was speaking. Dear child of God, what I want to say, I'm not seeking to condemn anyone. Look at our relationship with God. Don't let us be satisfied with this present state. He wants to speak to us plainly. He doesn't want to speak to us in parables. He wants to speak to us in the holy language. He doesn't want to use any interpreter or some other books from the library. He wants to directly deal with us. But will we become intercessors? Will we come to the Lord? Lord, these are the areas, Lord, I have been going wrong in my life. I want to be right with you. Shall we all stand up? Shall we, as the time is up, I want to close in prayer. Shall we ask the Lord, Lord, I find myself, Lord, I'm guilty before you. As Judah told, how shall I clear myself? Lord, you have found out my iniquity, O God. There are so many ways, Lord, I have been not right with you. I couldn't understand God is gracious. How often I thought God is hard on me. He is not hard. From the time that Joseph revealed himself to them, Joseph was never hard, always tender, gracious, compassionate, kind and loving. God may give us that. Tonight God may open our spiritual eyes. When we see the glory of Jesus, our lives will change. Our lives will be changed. Shall we all pray together that God may change us? Hallelujah. Open our heart. Open our mouth. Shall we all pray? Jesus. 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 Help me, O God. Help me, O God. Help me, O God. Help me, O God.
Oh God, Jesus, hallelujah. Change me, oh God. Change me, oh God. Change me, oh God. Oh God, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh Jesus, Jesus. I request every one of us, although we may not be singing now, just open your heart. Just 1 minute, cry out, dear child of God, we are far short of the standard of God. It's a great, great standard. He wants to speak to us most of the time. Your life and my life, we have been too much speaking to Him and we don't let Him speak to us. No, hereafter God wants to bring to His stage. He wants to speak to us more. He has so much to speak to us, dear children of God. He has so much to speak to us. Let's open up our heart. Let's open up our hearts and pray. Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, speak to my heart, O God. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Oh, Jesus, Jesus, hallelujah. Lord, help me, oh God. Change us, oh God. Change us, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we praise and thank you for this sweet time that you have given us. Our God is so gracious and compassionate. How many times we thought, why Jesus is so hard and dealing roughly with us. As Joseph arrested and kept some of them, Lord, some of the things we have gone through, Lord, appear to be, Lord, far beyond our understanding. Dear Lord, open, Lord, our spiritual eyes to see the state of our heart. Maybe, Lord, still we may be despising some dear ones. Even the youngest, even the lowest, even the smallest person, dear Lord, could be the greatest person in the presence of God. Forgive us, O God. Even the smallest person, help us to be united with them, not to despise them, but to prefer others better than ourselves. Dear Lord, make us intercessors, Lord. By His knowledge He shall justify many, for He shall bear the iniquities, O God. When are we going to learn to take the iniquities of others and justify others and to call the blame upon us so that, Lord, we can reconcile people to Christ. You have given us the ministry of reconciliation. Dear Lord, make us mighty intercessors, O Father. When you open our heart and see, let there be found nothing in our heart that is displeasing. Father, many of us have been grieving the Heavenly Father's heart. And some of us have already sent their literal physical fathers and mothers to the grave with a broken heart. Lord, I pray, let it not happen to our young people, those who are standing here. As the time God has given, help them to love and honor and respect and obey the parents so that their heart could be comforted and blessed. Let none of us love anybody more than, Lord, you want us to love. Otherwise, we know, Lord, one day they will become the source of great trouble and problem for us, as Jacob found. Thank you for all the lessons that we learned. Help us to live according to thy word, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passeth all understanding rest and abide with us all, now and until the Lord returns in glory. Amen. Amen.